Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised in the city of our God.
God's holy mountain is beautiful, the joy of the whole earth.
We ponder your steadfast love, O God.
Your name, O God, like your praise, reaches to the ends of the earth. Your right hand is filled with victory.
And our first hymn is on page 110. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing. And if you'd like to stand, if you're able, please. Doesn't that music sound so beautiful? Oh, thank you, Doris. We're so happy to have Doris and Prudy sharing their talent with us. Would you please join with me this praise? God of all life, we thank you for the signs of your love that surrounds us, for sun and warmth and all that comes in life within creation. For all that sleeps within the earth awaiting birth. We praise you for the wisdom of your care, water on the earth, sunlight on our spirits, hands on blinded eyes. Continue to touch us. Reach out to us with compassion and forgiveness, that we may receive your gifts, that we may know your love and grace, and rise to a new life in Jesus Christ. Amen. And now it's time for the children's story, and Paul Morris is going to have that.
So my story this morning is about an Indian. Okay. Usually you think of Indians, you think of cowboys and Indians or whatever, in the Old West and buffalo and cattle and everything. But this is an Indian. His name is Luke, and he lived in a reservation. Now, that's where Indians and stuff lived or whatever by that time, and I'm getting mixed up already, so bear with me. But anyway, this Indian believed in Jesus, and back at that time, one person asked him, "What has Jesus ever done for you?" And so indirectly, he stopped and he thought a little bit, and he got up. Yeah, and he went back, and they said it. He got, I'm falling apart already. And he got some sticks, And it's like Jesus did in the dirt or whatever, whenever he was talking to some Pharisees. Jesus got down and started marking in the dirt and dust and stuff. But Luke went and he got sticks and he started building something. Yeah. So you can help me if you want to. Okay. You want a stick? Okay. Okay. Can we build a box? Hey, we can all do this. Want another one?
Sydney and...
Okay, we got another one, yes. Okay, so after he built this box... Oh, got another piece. Yeah. There you go. So after he built this box or whatever, whenever he was picking up sticks and stuff on the ground, he saw a worm. So he got this worm, and he put it in the box. Now, indirectly, according to the story, he lit the box on fire. But we can't have fire in a church, can we? That wouldn't go too good. I know we're not that far from the fire company, but still. But anyway, the worm looked back and forth. He looked to the left, and there was no place out. He looked to the right. There was no way out. And he looked in the front and in the back. And he started getting worried. How am I going to get out of here? And according to the story, Luke went and he put his hand down inside the flame. And the worm crawled up on his hand. And he got out. And he made remark. He said, the guy that asked him the question, what has Jesus ever done for you? And he made remark, well, I'm just like that worm. He said, God was mad at me because I sinned. And he said, I was really worked up about it. But then Jesus died on the cross for my sins. And all that sin was wiped away. And he said, that's my thing on life or whatever, is Jesus, God was the God of all creation. Jesus came. He was the Son of God. He was born here and preached here. And he died on the cross. There you go. He died on the cross for our sins so that we could be forgiven of our sins. And that's what I look at life today or whatever, that God saved me and now I'm working for him. So this is my story this morning. So that's my story for this morning. And I got something to share with the congregation or whatever, that everybody says we pray to God all the time for things that we need and things that we want. And I got to doing this about 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, and everybody says you should be thankful for what you got. And I got to thinking, when you get older, whatever, you start forgetting things. Where did I put the keys? Where did I put my cell phone? And nothing else, you get on the landline, you call your cell phone to find where this ring is coming from. Unless, like at church, you turn the volume down and you But anyway, I got to the place that whenever I lose my keys and I find them, I'd say, thank you, Jesus. Or if you're out and something happens and you almost slip and fall, but you don't, and I say, thank you, Jesus. And indirectly, we do. When we pray for things that we need. Somebody's sick or, I'm worrying about this or whatever. This is one where we can serve Jesus too, or God also, is we need to start saying, thank you, Jesus, for the things that we have been blessed with. So that's my story for the kids and the story for you. So thanks for putting up with me.
Again, thank you. It's a beautiful morning, and we have some special people here this morning, which fills my heart with joy. I want to introduce you afterwards. You may say hello to Elena, and maybe you want to stand. This is our new secretary, and her good friend George Baker are here this morning, and we are just thankful to have you this morning. It's so good to see our little precious one, only a little over a week old. Ellie is here. After having some jaundice testing and a little bit of concerns this week, she's doing well. We're so glad for you all. It's also special to have Aunt Terry and Uncle Lowell. Amy's aunt and uncle, and we also welcome you and thank you for joining us. And there's a face or two that are here for the first time post-COVID. So Percy is one, and we're so glad to see Percy. He had a great week with his daughter from down south up visiting, and we're just glad for everyone who's joined together here for worship. All I need is you, Jesus, all I need is you. You are the source of all I need. All I need is you. Let's do that verse again. All I need is you, Jesus, all I need is you. You are the source of all I need. All I need is you. All I want is you, Jesus, all I want is you. You are the source of all I need. All I need is you. My only hope is you, Lord, my only is you. You are the source of all I need. My only hope is you.
He left that place and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and brother of James, and Joseph, and Judas, and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown, and among their own kin, and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Second session, the mission of the 12. Then he went about among the villages teaching. He called the 12 and began to send them out two by two, and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that place. If any place will not welcome you, and they refuse to hear you as you leave, shake off the dust that was on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them.
Well, again, it is just so very good to be to welcome you all. I hope, and it's my prayer, that you know that as you entered into our facility this morning, that you felt a sense of welcome, a sense of peace, and a sense of being at home. And I'm trusting that each of you has that place where you can take your shoes off, where you can kind of undo your tie and your shirt and kind of roll your sleeves up and feel safe and feel like you belong and feel like there's no pressure to be anything that you're not or to fit any roles that you don't feel comfortable with. I pray that we all have that place and that space where we really feel at home. And I want to invite you to think about places where you don't feel at home. For some of us, work is a place where we don't feel at home, where we feel anxious, where we feel stressed. One of the things I enjoy, one of the inventories we use for premarital counseling, it measures stress and how many stressors there are in your life. Well, at that point, a couple is going through all kinds of stress. And how you handle those is kind of illuminating to who your personality is and who you are. But when Jesus went back home, the idea is that this should be a safe place for him, right? This is his home synagogue. These are the folks he grew up with. And Jesus would have been attending the synagogue probably for 15 or more years before he went into this public ministry in his older 20s. And so Jesus walks into the synagogue and into his town, and instead of being welcomed with open arms and like, oh, we are so proud of you, our hometown boy making good on all that God is doing it for him, what was the response? It was skepticism, and that's probably being polite. It was out and out rejection. Who are you? You're one of us. You're Joseph and Mary's son. Where is all this attention and all of this fuss about what you're doing? Where did that all come from? And because of their lack of faith, the scripture, Mark tells us that Jesus couldn't do any of the things that he was doing by the sea or over in Gennesaret or in the surrounding towns, because he wasn't welcomed, because people couldn't put their faith in this man and his teachings as from God. And I know I alluded to that last week. Jesus was not welcomed. The disciples must have picked up on that. So the next story Mark tells, he introduces, is that they go. They leave that town, and then Jesus begins to put upon the disciples a sense of calling. In this beautiful short passage, Jesus names the 12. He calls them, and he points out what they probably have already known. They've been with Jesus for a little while now, that each of them has a special calling. You remember back when they were first called? I'm going to make you fishers of men. I'm going to make you fishers of people. You're going to bring people into the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. Well, they've gotten to hear Jesus' teachings. They've gotten to see Jesus doing these amazing miracles. They've been with him for a time. They saw the waves and the storm and the winds calmed. They saw demons cast out evil, cleansed from people. And now Jesus is about to send them to begin to do the same ministries on their own. One of these key phrases, he gave them authority. And it's interesting to think about that, whether that means they had this new experience of the Holy Spirit, or whether they really just had confidence of being in a connection with God like Jesus was. We don't know exactly what that means. But I can tell you, it's one thing that every young minister wrestles with. What does it mean to have authority to sit in front of or to stand in front of people and to speak about the word? What is that about? In our tradition and in many Christian churches, it's kind of imparted by this act, the symbolic act of ordination, where they lay hands upon us and they pray for that authority to come. Jesus gave it to the disciples, and then he sent them out. He called them, he equipped them, and he sent them. It's almost like he pushed them in the deep end when he really didn't know how to swim. I have a feeling that's what was going on here. Thankfully, he gave them the support of a partner. They went two by two, and they went out to teach. And Mark, as he shares, it's the main lesson was to repent. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. The very same words Jesus began the gospel with. John the Baptist came with the message, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Turn or change or align yourself with the will and the plan and the law of God. I wrestle with translating the story from first century to today. And I wonder how we as a church are doing at this work of calling, equipping, and sending people, disciples, into ministries. Not necessarily just within our congregational ministry team structure, but how are we doing at calling, equipping, and sending followers of Jesus into our community and into our world? How are we doing at that? And how do we take this, what Jesus was doing with the disciples, and bring that into our culture and into our time? First of all, I'd like to find 12 of you that are willing to spend night and day traveling around to all our different communities for 3 or 4 years, you know? Any volunteers for that? Maybe not. Okay. So what's going on here? How do we experience the sense that we are all given a purpose, a sense of calling? One of the books that I came upon this summer, my summer reading, is Another Way. It's by Stephen Lewis, Matthew Wesley Williams, Dory Granko Baker. And they are talking about an organization called FTE, the Forum for Theological Reflection or Exploration. And, you know, they're doing this. They are going around inviting people to think more deeply about just a handful of questions. They call them awakening, self-awakening questions. Their mentor was Howard Thurman. He was a black theology teacher, a mentor to Martin Luther King Jr. And they quote Thurman, and they kind of use his questions as a model. And Thurman, when he'd run into young people, he would ask them, "So who are you?" But he wouldn't take the first answer. He'd make this into a conversation. You know, if you're driving somewhere for an hour or two, they'd be talking about this question for the whole trip, you know? He would invite people to go deeper. Who are you? It's really interesting that another group of us are reading another book called Radical Optimism. And in that book, Beatrice Boutreau asks the same kind of question. She says, how do we discover who we are if we eliminate all of the relational dynamics from our descriptions? In other words, I'm Mike, I'm a pastor. Well, that's relational. That's not real, that doesn't really count. I'm Mike, I'm Amy's husband. No, go a little deeper. Who are you? Not necessarily in relation to anything that's going to end, but those things that are eternal. Who are you in God's eyes? As you look deeper than physical, deeper than relational, as you look deeper at that spark of life that makes you alive, you know, that spark that is eternal, who are you? And what are the passions or the dreams or what's the energy that turns you on in this world? And how do you find those energies in this journey to become a follower and a disciple of Jesus? I believe that whenever the disciples went out, as scared as they were, whenever they began talking about to people and telling the stories and telling about what they'd seen with Jesus, and they began telling all of this, I think that's when they found their hearts true home. These fellows were called and intended for this purpose. And when they found that purpose, it was like, it's like that's where they belong. That's where they fit. And apart from sensing that purpose from God and responding in positive ways to it, everything we do is going to be like Jesus in his hometown, where things just don't fit. They don't fit together right, where there is a disconnect. One of the things Thurman talked about is hearing the voice of the genuine. It's like hearing the voice of God. It's hearing the voice deep within that kind of speaks up whenever we get it right. It speaks up whenever we're doing something that really fits in with what God is intending for us. I wonder when you've noticed that. What were the moments whenever you just knew that it was in tune with God, what you were doing, what you were saying, where you were, who you were engaged with? I wonder what those moments were. Those would be wonderful things to talk about at dinner today. The voice of God, the voice of the genuine. Our church is wrestling with this. We're calling it compelling vision. And you know the statement, we've read it and we've heard it, and the annual conference affirmed it. Together we as the Church of the Brethren will passionately live and share the radical transformation, the holistic peace of Jesus Christ. Through relationship-based neighborhood engagement, to move us forward, we will develop a culture of calling and equipping disciples who are innovative, adaptive, and fearless. I would love for y'all to memorize that, but I'm not expecting that. And the details of that aren't really what matter. What matters is this sense that we are open to and looking for and listening for and responding to the sense of God leading us to that place where we're doing what God intends. We're fulfilling his purpose for us. Thurman writes beautifully about this. He says, every single living thing in all of creation has a purpose. That's the way creation worked. We all have a purpose. And if we think really holistically, we all fit together. When we're fulfilling our purpose, we complement and add to what's going on around us in this cosmos. As I wrestled with this, I thought about sin, and I think for this week, in this text, in this relationship, sin is probably being self-absorbed and working and doing things that don't complement what's going on around us, but instead focusing just on me, my dreams or my needs that aren't in relation to Jesus or to God or to the Word or to what's going on around us. I wonder how you have heard God's calling. And I would ask you to think about that in relation to these simple questions. Who am I? And then the second one, Thurman was famous for, is what do I want? Disciples on that journey discovered a sense of fulfillment, a sense of being at home, a sense of completion that translated into their wants. They were willing to follow the lead of the Spirit wherever because they felt such a keen sense of that fulfillment. Where have you felt that? I got to tell you, one of the things I've noticed is Tuesday night, after the meal, after we worked for a long time, serving a couple hundred meals, as we're turning the lights off, that's it. That's one of the moments. This is so satisfying. Just because it's what God's calling us to do at this moment? Where do you feel that voice of the genuine saying, yes, this is where it's at for you? And how do we as a congregation get better at helping each other discover, to listen, to hear, and to fulfill this purpose God has for us collectively in this place? Those are questions to ponder, to listen, to dwell on, to drive and lead us, to lead us forward. Let's pray. Help us, O God, to listen for your voice. Help us to hear you echoing and whispering deep within through the activities that we're engaged in. And help us to notice when your voice and your echoes seem to be in tune with our thoughts and activities and with the things we're doing, so that we might have a clear sense of purpose, your purpose, a clear sense of your leading. We understand sometimes, like the disciples, what it feels like to be not equipped or unprepared for new things. Take, O Lord, that fear from us and replace it with faith, confidence. Confidence that you will be the hand who lifts us up and encourages and empowers and facilitates whatever calling you give. Lead us, O Lord. Amen. Our hymn is a response. It's Here I am, Lord. It's number 395. I invite you, if you are comfortable and able, I would invite you to stand as we sing.
I have heard you.
from our bulletin. Before us, in the planned shape of this day, we look for unexpected surgings of new life. Around us in the people whom we know and love, we look for the unopened gifts of promise. Within us, in the familiar sanctuaries of our souls, we look for shinings of the everlasting light. Before us, around us, within us, we look for your life-giving mystery, O God. Before us, around us, within us. May we go forth, authorized by the Spirit to share hope, love, and peace with all we meet. Amen.